It's almost spring, everyone. Tornado season 2019 is just around the corner. Are we in for another big bust, or are we about to board the hype train to Wedgetown? Stay with me. 2018 was definitely not your year if you were a storm chaser based out of the southern plains especially. On May 1st, 2018, I managed to catch the Tescott, Kansas Wedge Tornado, which was really one of the only few chances I had all year. If you were storm chasing on May 1st, you may have been looking at a radar screen not unlike this one. Do you go south toward the southern target? Or stick with your target to the bitter end and stay with that middle storm? I was sitting out there with my phone, drawing this picture, wondering whether I should go after that southern target. We stuck it out and we stayed with that middle storm. So many others were not so lucky. Faced with a storm that was just dropping heavy rain and a little bit of hail and not really getting its act together, made it really tempting to want to go after that southern target. More of the story, even with a couple of storms in an environment that should produce tornadoes, it's entirely possible that neither will, or you pick the wrong storm of the day. Now casting is sort of a what's going on right now. What is the situation? What's going to happen next? You can't really predict tornadoes directly. You can only predict their precursors, supercells. Not all supercells will produce tornadoes, and not all environments that should produce supercells actually do. Definitely not all supercells will cooperate with storm chasers. So given the challenges of now casting and forecasting in the short term, why in the heck would somebody try and predict 4 months in advance what a storm season is going to be like? Certainly no normal meteorologist would go out of their way to make some wild claim about what the next season was going to be like 4 months in advance. Hold this. You'd have to be a real pessimist to think that 2018 would have turned out like it did. It's not like anybody's gonna predict that outcome with pinpoint accuracy. All right, fine, let's take a stab at this. So what tools do we have to make an educated guess just like Reed Timmer just did? We've got some climatology data we can look at, as well as some history. Storm chasing successfully and getting sweet shots of tornadoes isn't 100% dependent on having a season with high tornado counts. What really matters is clear views of tornadoes from empty countryside away from the jungles of the Deep South and the Ozarks. It's also got to be over a good road network. Years like 2011 had a high number of powerful, devastating tornadoes and a high tornado count overall, but it wasn't necessarily ideal for chasing photogenic tornadoes over empty fields in places like western Kansas. Then there are years like 2013 or 2007, when photogenic tornadoes were happening in spite of an otherwise slow tornado year. The scope that I've chosen for this, I'm going with something I've coined the Norman Index, which I'll cover in a few. Storm chasers want to see tornadoes in season and in an area of more ideal terrain, and within a roughly 10-hour drive of Oklahoma City, where many chasers, tour companies, scientists, and meteorology students base from. But this forecast could also have similar implications for the Deep South, the Midwest, and the Northern Plains. For me, there are two critical features that I look for this time of year to gauge the outcome of a season. The number one is drought. In the Southwest, and especially in the springtime, we have something we like to call the EML, or Elevated Mixed Layer Source Region. If you've ever heard the tired, old, oversimplified version on tornado documentaries and TV shows, this is the hot, dry air that moves in from the Southwest that meets with
warm, moist air,
being drawn in from the Gulf. It's fairly important that these areas are not in long-term, persistent drought. You can check out my climatology video here. But we don't want this region to be too wet either. Without this cap, we can expect messy storm modes all season, or interfering early storm convection to ruin the chances for severe weather that could result in tornadoes during primetime. So let's talk El Nino. The second major factor to watch out for is the jet stream. In order for a storm to become a supercell, some amount of shear and storm motion is going to be needed. For severe weather in the southern US, we need the jet stream specifically to dive south over the southern Rockies in April and May. Now, where El Nino comes into play is to affect the overall jet stream pattern over the continental US, sometimes in a big way. In a strong El Nino spring, the jet stream will typically carve across California more frequently, bringing the state some beneficial rain and snow all winter. El Nino's opposite, La Niña, often causes a blocking high pressure to form off the west coast of the United States, causing drought conditions over much of the southwest and southern plains. While La Niña typically means more tornadoes overall, these tend to be over the southern United States and the Ozarks, much less than ideal places to be storm chasing. Worse, that could also lead to a quiet season west of Interstate 35, where the best terrain is. Such was the situation in 2018. Drought conditions in the southwest, combined with a La Niña-like blocking high out west, that contributed to a very weak tornado year over the central, southern, and high plains during the spring. So with spring a couple of months away, where are we at right now?
The Climate Prediction Center places us currently in an El Nino watch. Conditions at the moment are La Nada, or nothing. Weak to moderate El Nino conditions are expected, though, later this winter, with a chance that may extend into parts of spring 2019. As far as the drought in the Southwest is concerned, right now there doesn't appear to be much of an issue. That's very good news for storm chasers. La Nada to moderate El Nino are generally considered good conditions for tornadoes on the western high plains, as far as bringing the jet stream south over the southern Rockies and out over the plain states as many times as possible during the spring. Meanwhile, the lack of drought means that when this does happen, concerns about moisture and capping should be about average, but perhaps better than most of the last decade. The last 10 years have made for somewhat tough storm chasing, though it has definitely had some highlight years. The two biggest failure modes we've seen repeatedly are capping issues and blocking high pressure out west. So let's have a look at climate models. One way we can gauge a spring season, or confirm what we think we already know, is to check out the CFS forecast. CFS stands for Can't Forecast for Sh**. Looking at spring as a whole, conditions look pretty decent. Generally speaking, calling for a pattern where western troughing is the most common scenario. Looking at each month in particular, May and June have the most pronounced pattern, though April isn't too terrible either. Same goes for precipitation outlook. It's really a function of the overall pattern. Not surprisingly, that western troughing patterns contribute to more rain than average on the high plains. That's good news, of course, but it doesn't mean storms. Much of the rain that falls on the high plains in these months comes from storms. So, seems like a good thing, right? Another competing model of the CFS sort of tells a similar story. So let's have a look at other years and compare current conditions with the tornado statistics from previous years. What I'm doing here is assigning a value to each individual tornado. Was it an EF0 with no damage path? That's weighted lower than an EF2 with a significant damage path over half a mile long. Also, this data only includes the northern half of Texas, western and central Oklahoma, and all of Kansas. An example of why this data isn't perfect, 2013 was arguably a better year for storm chasing for most people than 2015 was. While 2013 didn't have high counts, the tornadoes we did get were excellent, while 2015 had fairly average counts, but many of them were weak, grungy tornadoes embedded in squall lines. But clearly some of the most notable years in storm chasing history stick out quite well, such as 2003, 2007, 2010, and 1991. So let's now label all of the years with somewhat similar conditions, little or no drought, and a neutral to weak El Nino. So far, that's not a ton of correlation, but some years are better analogs than others. In yellow are the best analogs, and in orange are not so good analogs. These not so good ones might have been El Nino years, but perhaps not during the right season, or maybe we were transitioning out of a weak La Nina. If we cherry pick only the most similar analog years, here's what we get. By the Norman Index, these are pretty impressive years overall. And if you're skeptical about my index, I'll replace it with just tornado days in Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. Turns out to be about average. But again, these were good storm chasing years in general. Or how about the entire plains? How do these same analog years stack up? Still looks good to me. Let's highlight a couple of these. 2004 was the year of the record-breaking Hallam, Nebraska tornado, and also saw a record-breaking May tornado outbreak over Memorial Day weekend of that year. The total tornado count was well above average. 2007 was the year of the Greensburg tornado and the famous Arnett drill bit. The rest of the year was actually below average, but the western high plains in Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas were quite high, and tornadoes were particularly strong that year. 2015 saw high tornado counts overall in the plains, but many were spawned by high precipitation supercells and squall lines, which made chasing them less than ideal. 2015 was actually a very wet year. It was a year of too much of a good thing and diminishing the overall quality.
1991 though. 1991!
Hey, it survived the cut. I'll show you just a couple of teaser clips. So yeah, 1991 was the year before the movie Twister was pitched to Steven Spielberg. One particularly whole day long outbreak.
This is gonna be a long day.
Of violent tornadoes taking place over northern Oklahoma and southern Kansas has a few, let's say, inspired similarities to the movie. Well, that speaks for itself, I'm sure. But 1991 was a special year, unlikely to be matched in 2019. But who knows?
So then what's my conclusion? I can be certain of one thing. 2019 will be nothing like 2018. I hope. But I don't think we exactly get a spring full of tornado outbreaks either. I think what we can expect instead is an average year, but with better storm chasing conditions than we've been dealing with in the past. In other words, more high plains chasing, more predictability than we've gotten used to, and overall, a better year to catch pretty twisters over open prairie. So based on all this, here's my bold, enthusiastic prediction for storm season 2019. Now don't take these predictions too seriously. I'll definitely have to follow up on this forecast at the start of May. And I'll also do a postmortem at the end of June to see how this pans out. So be sure to subscribe so you can see my complete lack of shock and utter embarrassment. Or maybe I'll have some good video for you in a couple of months. Until then, here's to 2019. Cheers.